Welcome to Christ the King Church, Shelby, North Carolina.
Hi, welcome to Christ the King Church. I'm Melinda, Pastor Moore's daughter. I want to welcome you to the service today, but I want to take a moment and tell you about some of our services here at Christ the King through the week. On Sunday morning, from 10 to 10:30, we have Sunday school. At 10:45, we have communion, which is open to all baptized believers. At 11 o'clock, we start our worship service. At the end of our worship service, we have a time of ministry where our elders will anoint you with oil and pray over you for healing or whatever your need may be. On Wednesdays at 7 o'clock, we have our regular midweek service. On Thursday, this is our little special meeting that I want to take a moment and explain to you about. It's called our Healing Room Evening. It's from 6:30 to 8, and it's a time of teaching and ministry time. The teaching is from 6:30 to 7:30 because we believe that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. At 7:30 to 8, it's the ministry portion of it, in which we have a group of people that will pray over you for whatever your need may be it physically, financially, emotionally, mentally, whatever you desire prayer for, they will come in agreement with you about. Also, if you do not have a specific need that you want prayer over, feel free to come and join us anyway from 6:30 to 7:30 during the teaching time. At this time, again, I would like to welcome you, and we will join the ministry now.
Lord, I just pray right now for Pastor Vernon and Barbara. Father, we just pray right now, and we command healing to come to them in Jesus' name. Healing come in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for them. We thank you for the heart that they have, how they love this church and they love the people of this church. And Lord, we just stand together as a united body and we speak healing to them in Jesus' name. We just thank you for it, Lord. We expect it. And Father, we are grateful that you told us that by your stripes we're healed. We remember, Lord, that Jesus was anointed by the Holy Ghost, and he went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And he's been with us, and he's given us that power and that authority. So we thank you for that, Lord, and for quick healing in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to, first of all, before I get into the word, I want to just say thank you to everybody who prayed for us. We had a really nice visit while we were in Texas over the Christmas holiday. The driving was difficult. We saw wrecks everywhere, but God took us through safely. We didn't even have any close calls, which is kind of unique. We normally have at least one, and we didn't have any this time. So we're just so thankful that God brought us through that in the driving. It was foggy and raining out there and all the way back. But God took care of us through all of that. And as I said, we saw wrecks. We saw a truck off in a ditch. Had hit a tree where he ran off the road. We saw cars crash together everywhere, but God kept us safe, and we're so thankful that he did. And we had just a really good time with our family. Got to see a lot of Carla's family that we hadn't seen in several years. Got to be with several of my family. So we just really did we had a great time. God really blessed us, and we're very thankful that we had such a good time. Everything went so well. We had wonderful weather. It was 80 degrees on Christmas Day. So that was unique. And so we've been there at times where it was really bad, but this time it was beautiful, like I say, 80 degrees. So people tell you that you can feel when you're praying for them. Let me tell you, we could. We knew this church was praying for us, and so we're thankful for your prayers. I want to talk to you this evening about the prosperity of your souls. Why is that important? Well, if you stop and think about it, there's a lot of people study the soul. The Greek word for soul is psyche. So people who are psychologists or psychiatrists, what they've done is make a study of people's minds and how they think and what they do, because your soul is your mind, your emotions, your thought process, your will, your personality, and your conscience. So it's really all these things. Now, we have to understand the difference between our spirit and our soul. You realize that we're a trinity as well, do you not? We're spirit, We live in a body, and we have a soul. So we're kind of a trinity in that respect also. The real us is our spirit man. That's the difference. That's who we are, is what is our spirit. This body is just the house we live in while we're here on earth. You have to have, as Vernon calls it, an earth suit to live here on the earth. This is how we come in contact with everything while we're on the earth. But eventually, our body is going to die, but our spirit never dies. We're going to be somewhere for eternity after we leave this body. So you see, it's important for us to understand there's a difference. We can look at it, and you know, our spirits are capable of living outside of these bodies that I just mentioned. When we die, our spirit goes. It goes and lives. Whether we accepted Jesus, we go to heaven. If we die and we don't believe in Jesus, then we go to hell. I mean, there's no really in-between place. You'll hear people talk about purgatory. I can't find that in the Word anywhere. We're one place or the other. Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I had somebody say, well, I don't know whether we really go to heaven or not. I'm not sure. Well, if it's true that when I die, I go to be with Jesus, I don't care where that is. Wherever He is going to be heaven. Because that's the one we've served and where we want to go to. But I believe we're going to be in heaven. So, I'm just so excited about the fact that we have that hope. We have that to look forward to. This is not the end. We're not like some people who say, well, you die and that's just it. It's over with. There's others who believe you die and nothing happens until the resurrection day. They call it soul sleep. I don't believe in soul sleep. I don't find that in the Bible either. So you see, what I've tried to base everything on is just like Vernon does. We try to base it on what's in the Word of God. That's what's going to judge you one day. That's the only place we need to look for to get our wisdom is in the Bible. Because we want God's wisdom. Man's wisdom doesn't mean anything. Men can think they're so smart, but God can do things that man says is impossible. And He does it all the time. You know, when we get to heaven, it says we're going to be given a new body. But we're still going to be us. Everything you've done, everything you've experienced, you're going to remember. You remember it talked about when the rich man and Lazarus both died. And they said they remembered how they lived before. They remembered people. The rich man was worried about his family and wanted to have Lazarus go back and tell him, man, you got to do right because we don't want you coming to this horrible place. So he remembered. Our memories will be with us. A lot of things will be with us. But I'll guarantee you one thing I truly believe. There will be no pain. There will be no sorrow. 30 seconds in heaven, we won't worry about anything else. Everything else has no meaning. Because when you're in the presence of God and you're in that place He's prepared for us, it's truly going to be paradise for us. So we don't have to worry about that. Now, I want to show you a few scriptures just to kind of prove some things to you. Because I'm going to be talking about your soul a lot, and I want you to see why. If you'll look at Hebrews 4:12, I want to show you what the Word says. Because as you say, you'll have people who will argue and say that your spirit and your soul are the same thing. But I want to show you what the Word says about our spirit and our soul. Hebrews 4:12 says this, for the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So we see right there that the Word of God tells us there's a difference between our soul and our spirit. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians. I'll give you a couple of these because out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word needs to be established. So let's look at 1 Thessalonians. I know it's in my Bible somewhere. There it is. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Look at verse 23. Chapter 5, verse 23 of 1 Thessalonians says this, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. There's another one that tells us spirit and soul are different. Now my final one here for this one is 2 Corinthians 5:17. I just want to lay a little groundwork for what we're going to be talking about. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says this. 2 Corinthians 5:17 just says this. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. When you get saved, your spirit is saved. Your spirit's as saved as it's ever going to be. You're saved. And if we could get that through our heads, the devil will try to say, well, you know, you messed up and you failed and you fell. By the grace of God, we're saved. And it's not dependent on us. If it was, we'd never be good enough. That's why Jesus came, died for us, and He bought us, and we're saved because of what Jesus did. But your spirit is saved when you accept Jesus as your Savior. Now, what's the difference is, you can be saved and be the most miserable, defeated person that's ever been on the face of the earth. Because you're not taking care of your soul. And as I say, I'm going to dig into that a little bit. But I want you to see, we're not talking about your salvation. We don't get saved through works. The Word says we're saved by grace, not of works, so that none of us can boast. We have nothing to boast about. We didn't save ourselves because we couldn't. If we could have, Jesus would have never had to come. So you see, that takes a little burden off of me and realizing that I'm not worried about my salvation as much as I am. I want to be victorious. I want to live a good life. I want to live where I'm walking above all the circumstances of life. That's what God wants for us. Now there's a scripture we talk about often, and I think sometimes we kind of skim over it. 3 John. Verse 2. I'll give you a minute to get there. 3 John, verse 2. I hit on this a little bit a few Wednesdays ago, but it was very short, and I want to really have an opportunity to dig into this. 3 John, verse 2 says this. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. What does that mean? If your soul doesn't prosper, you're going to have problems prospering financially. You're going to have problems prospering in your relationships. You're going to have problems with your health because you're not taking care of your soul. I'm going to show you some of the ways that we do that. But our prosperity and our health are dependent on the state of our souls. Now, there are some ways that we can improve the state of our souls. Turn with me to Romans 12 and verse 2. Romans 12. And verse 2. And this is one of the ways. It says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now I'm going to show you some other steps, but look at this. How do we renew our mind? He tells us to renew our minds. That's something that we have to do. We have to take responsibility for it. You know, I've never seen a generation since I've been alive that's more lazy and thinks they're owed things than what we've got right now. I'm sorry to say that, but it's the truth. People don't want to work. They want you to give them everything. They think you owe them. don't owe those people anything. They need to get off their butts and go to work.
Amen.
But you see, that same type of mentality is in the church. We think God's going to ought to do everything for us. And I hate to tell you this, but God's already done everything He's ever going to do for us. The thing He's told us is to take care of some of this stuff ourselves. He's given us everything we need to live a victorious life. But it doesn't fall like ripe cherries out of heaven on our heads. It's something that we have to work for. I'm not talking about your salvation, remember. I'm talking about how you live your life. Do you have a victorious life? You want to stay defeated all the time? Dennis, I saw your post, and you know, I told you, I really believe that 2017 is going to be a victorious year. But it's only going to be victorious to the level of which we put our hand to it and help make sure that comes about.
Amen.
It's not going to be done all for us. I get tired. You know, if I'm too bold for you, I'm sorry. I know Vernon, he's pretty bold himself. But I'm going to tell you this. I'm so tired of people praying and said, "Oh God, make me holy. Oh God, do this for me. Oh God, do that for me." When God's saying, "What are you doing? I've already taken care. I've provided everything you need. All you have to do is start using it." The devil's already defeated, and yet we let him kick us around like we're a ball. Why do we do that? We haven't renewed our mind. We don't understand who we are. You see, he has no authority over us. The only authority he has is what we allow him to have. We don't have to be sick all the time. But we'll sit back, and the flu's going around. Well, I bet I'll get it. Why would you even want to say that? If you say that, you probably will. There's a very important... I used to tell Vernon, I used to think that this was the Kenneth Hagin quotation. But in Mark 11:24, it says, basically it tells us we're going to have whatever we say. So we need to be careful what we say. If you don't want it, don't say it. If you don't want it, don't say it. If we would just control our mouths sometimes, we would see how much better off we'd be by not saying negative things and not being so quick. This is something that my wife mentioned to me the other day, and it stirred up in me. I don't want to hear anybody else say, "Well, at your age, that makes me mad." Because what is age? Who told you that just because you got older, everything had to fall apart?
Right.
Some doctor. Somebody who's going to make money off of you falling apart. That's why they want to tell you that. And we'll just say, "Well, you know, I guess because it's my age, because I'm that age, I'm going to have these problems." Well, that's the dumbest thing. You just invited all up. Come on in. Here I am. I decided not long ago, I'm not going to worry about how old I am. It's just, I like what I saw. Age is just a number when really our age is our attitude.
Amen.
What do you believe about yourself? I got tired of hearing all this stuff. "Well, you know, when you get this age, this happens and that happens and this quits working and that won't work too good and all these things happen to you." Who said? Do you remember? The children of Israel were going in to take the promised land. Caleb was over 80 years old. What did he say? "I'm just as strong today as I was when I was 20 years old." Now, God's not a respecter of persons. That's what my Bible tells me. So if Caleb can say that, why can't we? Why do we put up with some of the stuff that we put up with? The devil has no authority to put all these things on us, but we'll sit back and we'll allow him to run roughshod over us if we would just resist him, as the Word says, use the Word of God. You know, when Jesus was taken in and tempted, he spent 40 days. Now, if you read the Scriptures, it's interesting. We always think about the fact that at the end of those 40 days, The devil came to tempt him. Okay? But there's other scriptures, the way they read, make you think that he was under attack the full 40 days. So he already had 40 days of being under attack. But then the big one came. They were just the little menial demons that were trying to attack him. Then Satan shows up and says, hey, if you're the Son of God, so see, the first thing he'll do is, if you're a child of God, why is this happening to you? He did it to Jesus. Why isn't he going to do it to you? If you're a child of God, why is this happening? He'll try to cast doubt on whether you're a child of God when you know in your heart you're a child of God. That's all you need to think about. I am a child of God. We're told in the Word that if we're Christ, then we are Abraham's seed and we're heirs of the promises that God gave Abraham. Those promises are prosperity and long life and health, all these things, and yet we forget who we are. Christians, the Church of Jesus Christ on this earth, by and large, is living way below what God wants us to live. He wants us to live a lot higher than we are, but we've allowed the devil to tell us, you're not good enough, which we're not. But it's not based on how good we are. It's based on what Jesus did. Jesus provided everything we need. And it's not about me anymore. It's about Him. It's about what He wants to do through me. It's just not about me anymore. Now the thing I've got to do is decide, do I want to be victorious? Do I want to live a life where I can go through and I can enjoy prosperity and good health, all those good things that God wants us to have? Or am I going to settle for what the devil's been telling me I have to have? I'm tired of hearing about Christians being just beaten over the head by the devil when if they would just use what God's given us, we'd be in good shape. Here's the problem. As I said, this generation is lazy. It's crept into the church. We want God to do everything for us. I would hate to ask, and you guys are special because you're here on Wednesdays. It took extra effort. So I may not be talking to you. But I wonder if you ask people in the congregation as a whole, how much time do you spend in the Word? How much time do you spend in prayer? If the only time that you're hearing the Word or reading the Word or praying is on Sunday morning, you're not going to make it. That's not enough. We can't live, and I don't know whether you guys realize this or not, there has to be a special anointing on people who preach and teach and all those things, but every one of you have an anointing from God. And you can't live on yesterday's anointing. You have to get a fresh anointing every day. Just like you remember when the children of Israel were out in the wilderness and God gave them fresh manna every day. That's what He wants to do with us. He wants to give us a fresh anointing every day so that we can stand up to whatever comes around. I was reading today where one of the prophets was complaining. Complaining, complaining, complaining. And God said, if you're having trouble with these footmen, what are you going to do when people on horses come? If you're having trouble right now, what are you going to do when you have to cross the Jordan when it's swollen over its banks? And the problem is we're letting the footmen of the devil keep us down because we're not putting ourselves to work and doing what God's called us to do. You want to know why we haven't seen so many miracles in this church? We don't believe for them. God's not limited, but we're limiting Him. You remember where Jesus said, it said about Jesus, He went into his hometown. He said he could do there no mighty works, except he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And it was because of their unbelief. Now, for those of you who have been watching this, I just want to give you an opportunity. If you want to hear the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey used to say, go to our Facebook page or our YouTube page, and you'll get the rest of the story. I think it's important that you do that because God's really given us some things that we need to know about. Turn with me to Jude. Jude, and we're going to look at verse 20. As I said, God's given us direction on what to do, how we can be victorious. I'm sick and tired of living in situations where I feel like the devil's beat me up because he has not that authority. I've given it to him too much, as most of you have too, and it's time for us to break out and tell him enough's enough. We're not going to keep on this way. Jude 20. Now, this is one of the ways that you can improve the state of your soul. It's by one, as I mentioned earlier, renewing your mind, and part of renewing your mind, look at what Jude 20 says. This is one of the ways we do it. But ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to ask another question. When was the last time some of you prayed in tongues? Don't shout me down because I'm preaching real good. When was the last time you prayed in tongues? Yet he says here, we build ourselves up on our most holy faith by praying in the Holy Spirit. Now, every time you find that in the Bible, it means you're praying in tongues. What's another way? Let's look at John 8:31. I don't like to tell you there's an issue without giving you a little bit of the solution. I have a friend who wrote a wonderful book. I read it, and he outlined the problems really good, but he never told you how to fix it. And if I have to go back and tell him, the next time I talk to him, I'm going to say, I loved your book, except you quit too soon. You didn't tell us what the solution was. If you're going to tell me there's a problem, help me find out the solution. So I said, first of all, we're going to renew our minds. How do we do that? Praying. And look at John 8:31. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. See, it's important for us to get into the Word of God. This is what I said, we get too lazy. We don't read the Word. We don't pray. We don't use the gifts that God has given us. And therefore, we end up defeated and having all kinds of problems. Now, go back with me to the Old Testament, to Joshua. And I want to go back and look at Joshua chapter 1, and I want to look at verse 8. You want to see how God wants us to live our lives? Go back and read the first book of Joshua. Or the first chapter of Joshua, excuse me. God tells Joshua over and over and over again, be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous over and over and over again. Look what he says here in Joshua 1:8. He says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that's written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Doesn't that sound a lot like John 3:2 that we read a little while ago? But he tells us what to do. He said, meditate on the Word. Keep the Word of God in you. Study the Word of God. Our relationship with God is based upon the amount of time we spend in the Word. You see, everything we need to know about God is written right here. All the promises that He's given us are written down right here. The problem is, we don't put them to use. We don't appropriate them for ourselves. You know, it's just like, if I gave you a gift, if I gave you an envelope with $500 in it, It's a gift. What do you have to do? Receive it. If you don't receive it, and then second of all, if you don't use it, what good has it done? I should have just kept the money in my pocket. If you don't use it, and that's what God has done. He's given us everything we need. And He says, just use what I've given you, and you'll be victorious. I don't want to see people continuing to live in defeat. Now, what's another way that we can improve our souls and cause it to prosper? John 6:53. I could quote this, but I want you to see it in the Word. John 6. Really, you could start reading in about verse 35 and read pretty well all the way down to 58. But I want you to focus on this one verse here. John 6:53. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink His blood, you have no life in you. We make available to you every Sunday the body and the blood of Christ. So one of the ways to improve your soul is to partake of Holy Communion. And we make it available to you. And I'll guarantee you, if we truly, and we've come a long way, but there's people here still who don't understand the importance of the Holy Communion, of partaking of the body and the blood of Christ. I've told people this before. If you question it, find me another place in the Bible where you come in contact with the blood of Jesus other than the Holy Communion. I've been a student of the Word for a lot of years. I can't tell you, there's not one. It's only at communion where you really come in contact with the blood. So that's another way. I believe, because the Word says it, Jesus said it. He said, this is my body and this is my blood. I don't question that. That's spiritual. I'm not going to try to tell you that it turns into physical flesh and physical blood. But Jesus said, as far as you're concerned, when you take it, you're eating my flesh and you're drinking my blood. That's important for us because He says, if we do it, we'll have life in us. And we wonder why there's so many dead Christians running around. It's because they go to dead churches where they have the same dead things all the time. They don't partake of communion. They have no life in them because they're not even taking time to figure out where the life comes from. And then they wonder why things are so rough. And I believe what the Word says, you know, the Word says that if they went out from us, then they weren't really of us. Because if they had been of us, they wouldn't have went away from us. And I don't understand how people can do that. When you come here and hear what you hear and are exposed to what you're exposed to, and you can leave here and go somewhere that doesn't observe communion and doesn't understand the body and the blood of Christ, doesn't believe, if you're sick, I'll guarantee you, you're going to hunt out a church that believes in healing. The doctor tells you you got cancer, you're going to find somebody who believes in healing. Because you want to be healed of that cancer. You don't want to die. Well, I've seen people come in, get healed of cancer in this church, and leave. Now, I'd be scared to do that because if God's healed me of cancer, I want to stay there where I got it because I want to keep it. And I've seen people who've got it and gone out where they're in an unbelieving church and lose their healing. And then they'll try to say, well, I guess I never really had it. No, dummy. You had it and you lost it because you went back in unbelief where you allowed people to talk you out of it.
Amen.
Turn with me over to 1 Peter. I'm going to try to unplug here soon. Promise. Try to, anyway. 1 Peter 3. We're going to look at 15 through 17. Listen to what he says here. He says, But sanctify the Lord in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it's better if the will of God be so that you suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. I guarantee you there's people in Shelby that talk crap about us all the time.
Amen.
And I really don't care. Because I believe we're doing what God's called us to do. We still believe in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. I have no problem laying my hands on someone and praying for them and believing and trusting God that they're going to get healed. Sometimes it's immediate. Sometimes it may take a while. But I guarantee you, I have no problem doing that because I've seen God do it. I have no problem telling people that there's still a baptism of the Holy Spirit where you speak in tongues. And tongues are not probably the biggest thing. But what do tongues do? It says you build yourself up when you pray in tongues. So it's important. So I want you to understand this. We talk about sanctifying. It says in verse 15, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. How do you do that? What does that mean? It means to make something holy, to give something holy status. And when we recognize how holy God is, man, you want to serve Him. I want Him to be happy with me. I'll tell you, I don't want to get to heaven and hear Jesus say, well, you made it in, but you lived a pretty crummy life because you wouldn't use what I told you to use. You didn't live according to the Word. You didn't live according to all the gifts that I gave you. And that's why your life was like that. And realize then that, man, it didn't have to be that way. It could have been a lot better. Final one. We're in 1 Peter. Go back to chapter 1. And verse 13. This is always an interesting verse to me. It says, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, what does that mean? What is gird up? You hear this a lot of times in the Word talking about gird up your loins. What does that mean? It means prepare your mind for work or battle. This is what it says in the Amplified Bible. It says, so brace up your minds. Be sober, circumspect, morally alert. Set your hope wholly and unchangeably on the grace, the divine favor that is coming to you when Jesus Christ the Messiah is revealed. And this is one of those things that God tells us to do. Take care of what goes into your mind. There are things that come, you're going to be thoughts that the enemy tries to give you.
Right.
Now, your thing is this. You don't have to receive those thoughts.
Amen.
The Word tells us to take control of our thoughts. We don't have to dwell on the junk the enemy gives us. We can rebuke that and we don't have to receive it. The problem is when he puts a thought in your mind and you let it sit there and you dwell on it and you let it percolate a little bit and you're thinking about it, and you can talk yourself out of a lot of things listening to his lies. But you got to be careful. There's things on TV you don't need to watch. There's movies you don't need to go see. There's people you don't need to be around because they're negative and they drag you down every time you're with them. You feel it when you get around them. So see, it may require that we change some friends. It may require that we use a little bit more judgment about what we watch, what we read, what we allow to be in our minds. Because he tells us here, the Amplified says, be morally alert. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm disturbed by a lot of the commercials I see on television. The old adage, sex sells? Oh yeah, they're trying to do that big time. So you're bombarded with some of this stuff, even if you got the television turned on. You got to be careful. How do you deal with that? Do you allow that to come into your mind, or are you able to deal with that and not allow it to take over your thought life? Excuse me. Jesus has provided everything we need to be successful. And he says the big key is we have to keep our minds renewed. Let me just review with you. Pray. Read the Word. Meditate the Scriptures. Come take Holy Communion. Sanctify God in our hearts. And gird up the loins of your mind. If you do those things, you're going to be victorious this year. I'm just giving you, if you want 2017 to be better than 2016, I'll guarantee you, I'd put it in writing. If you do those things, it's going to be a lot better year. I'm just going to finish up with this. We see too many Christians who have to be on anxiety medications, depression pills. Why? Because we're not doing these things. Now, my friend, our resident psychologist, Melinda Moore, the good thing is she's a Christian psychologist. She went to Oral Roberts University. She knows and she sees things from a Christian perspective. But she'll tell you that there are some things that you have a chemical imbalance, and I'm not going to tell you you need to get off all your medication. Because there are chemical imbalances that can cause you to be depressed and have other issues. So, if that's the case, you need to take your medicine. Please, for our sake, take your medicine. But what I'm saying is this. We have a part in how well our lives go. And we see far too many people who are defeated and walking around with their heads hung down because we've gotten lazy. There is a spirit, I think, in the world today of just, I just call it laziness. Just, I'm owed something. Let me tell you something. God doesn't owe you anything. He's given you everything you need already. And all he says is, take the gifts I've given you, do what I've told you to do, and we're not earning, as I said, I want to make sure you understand, I'm not talking about earning our salvation. We've already got that. But how can we be really a good example? You know, I tell people, you're the only Jesus that some people will ever see. If you claim to be a Christian, you're the only Jesus some of them are ever going to see. They're going to judge Jesus on the way you live your life. They're going to judge Jesus on the way you treat them and on the way that you your life goes. And if you're a sorry testimony for Jesus, then they're going to say, man, you ain't got nothing that I want. You're no better off than I am. My life stinks, but so does yours. So what have you got that I need? So you see, it's up to us to do the things that God's called us to do so that we can show the world that there is something better. And it's not just, Jesus said that He came to give us life and life more abundantly. That's not all in the by and by when we die and in the sky. It's right here and now. He wants His people to have some joy. Which is one thing you don't see a lot in the church anymore, is joy. We base all of our joy on our circumstances when joy is not based on your circumstance. Happiness can be based on your circumstances, but joy should be something that's in you that circumstances can't take away. Amen. Because our joy, we have that as a fruit of the Spirit. So you see, some of us need to start working on our trees a little bit and helping the fruit to grow instead of keeping doing things that cause the trees to start trying to die. We need to bear a lot of fruit. And it's not just for our advantage. It's so that other people will look at us and say, you know, there's something different about you. I'd like to know what that is. Because I know I don't have what you have. I remember years ago, back in about 76 or 77, that seemed like 100 years ago to me, I had a guy kept inviting me to church, and it was a spirit-filled church. I'd been brought up a Baptist like many of us have. But I remember I finally gave in and went to his church. And when I went in, the Spirit of God hit me so hard. And I don't remember a thing the preacher said. I cried the whole service. I couldn't tell you what he said. But at the end of that service, I remember getting down on my knees and saying, God, I don't know what these people have, but I want it. And you see, that's what I want for you. I want other people to be able to look at you and say, I don't know what they've got, but I sure do want it. And you see, it's up to us to be that light. Jesus said, while I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. But after he was going to leave, he said, now you're the light of the world. We've been given a big challenge. We're supposed to be light. We're supposed to show everybody the way and have them desire and say, I want what you've got. So I just challenge you. Think on the things that I've shared with you tonight. I really felt God put those on me big time. And I want this year to be better. Last year was a hard year. I had a lot of things going on, and it's not about me, but I'm just going to tell you, I had a lot of things going on last year. It was a tough year. But through it all, God did a lot of healing in me, physically, spirit, well, we talk spiritually, but really in my soulish realm. God healed a lot of things in me. And because I needed the time to be able to heal up. And he did it, and he took care of it. But it was hard going through that because I wanted things to happen really quickly, and they didn't happen real fast. It took some time. And I've learned more and more about patience, having to be patient. But we need patience. We need patience to understand that you're not always going to get an instantaneous miracle. But you need to be patient. Don't ever say, well, I guess it didn't work. It won't now. I had one lady one time, I'll never forget it. She came up had me lay hands on her. She had been stung on her arm by a bunch of wasps, and her arm was swollen up twice its size. Now, she had me lay hands on her and pray for her, and it didn't happen immediately. She came back the next Sunday and said, I just kept thanking God for my healing. She said, when I woke up Monday morning, my arm was totally healed. So have a little patience. Everything's not instant. We live in a microwave society. We want everything now. We want it instantaneously. But hey, have a little patience. I'll finish this one story. I was listening today. An evangelist was in a meeting place, and he said there was a guy sitting on the front row that was totally, every joint in his body had arthritis in it. He said the guy could not hardly move. He said, I tried to flow by the Spirit, and he said, I was calling people out, but he said, the first night, I didn't call this guy out. The guy came the second night. He said, I didn't call him out. The third night, he came. I didn't call him out. He said, this went on until the seventh night, and he said that guy came every single night because he wanted his healing. And he said on the last night, I called him out, I laid hands on him, he was cured instantly and started running around the church. Now what if he'd have given up after the third day? What if he would have given up after the fourth day? What if he had just said, well, I guess it's not for me, as so many of us do? That's where we need some patience and need to say, bless God, healing's mine, and I'm not going to leave here till I get it. If I have to come back 100 times, I'm going to get it.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. I just pray, Lord, that everyone would be encouraged to know that you have provided everything we need. It's up to us to use the gifts that you've given us so that we can not only be saved, which is wonderful, but Lord, I want to live a victorious life, and I believe the people here want to also. So help us, Lord. May your Holy Spirit speak to us. Show us areas of our life that we need to improve upon, that we need to change. Help us, Lord, to be all that you've called us to be. Now, Lord, I pray your blessings on everyone as they leave. Lord, thank you that we don't even have to lay hands on people for them to receive their healing tonight. Your Holy Spirit is here, and you're ministering to people to even now. Let them just claim the healing, God, that you have for them, and let them leave here knowing and expecting, Lord, that you are truly our healer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 The Lord be with you.
Thank you for joining us. My prayer for you this week is that you have made Jesus Lord of your life. If not, I pray that you would have a personal visitation from him this week in which you do accept him as Lord of your life. Thank you, and we will see you next week.
Thank you for watching Christ the King Church. Follow us on Facebook, and you can also see our sermons published on YouTube.